Hello, everyone, and welcome to the show. That's right, Local Chat episode 57 is in full swing, and we are here to talk about video games, to talk about mergers, acquisitions, and Pokemon. That's right, folks, we're going to be talking about a lot of things this week. Joining me is Ian Gibson making a face that I'm not entirely okay with.
I didn't realize we were on episode 57. I'm both proud of ourselves. I'm also a little scared that we have done it this much, and honestly a little sad that we don't have a lot more viewers and listeners by now. But
only 12
but, you know,
more to go.
We stuck with it, and we're going to keep doing it. This is fun.
That's true. Jake Terrio, what do you think about our lack of listeners?
You know, I've never listened to a podcast that isn't one of ours.
What? Jake, you're missing out on a world of fantastic.
Well, I know.
Okay, I'll give you a caveat because I did make you listen to an episode of Comedy Bang Bang and the Easy Allies, but I don't think
that's true. I was a captive audience.
Yeah, but that doesn't really count because it's really, when you say listen to, it's like that you subscribe.
And yeah, I guess I've also overheard podcasts that Hazel listens to, but...
Gotcha. I've started. I actually started the Giant Beast Cast since the beginning, and it's super weird to like.
Well, you've been saying this for like 4 years.
What? I just started it a week ago.
Say this for like 4 years.
I do feel like I've heard you say that before.
Oh, I just started like a week ago. Anyways, but it's like super weird because they were starting off talking about like The Witcher 3 just came out. And now, I think this past episode, they were like, oh, I wonder what Rocksteady's working on. When are they going to announce that? And I'm like...
I started listening to the Beastcast on a whim, and I listened to the very first episode the week it came out as I was driving past New York City on like a midnight cannonball run to Canada, from Baltimore to Canada. And it was just so crazy because I was like, oh, is this new? I should start listening to it. And it's one of my favorite podcasts. And I just happened to be there at the beginning all the way through. It's great. It'll be a fun ride.
Yeah. Yeah. It's I forget what episode I started on, but it was in the 100s. So I'll eventually catch back up, but it's working out. Folks, there's plenty to talk about this week. But first we got to talk about games we've been playing, and just so happens that all of us sweet little boys have been playing the exact same game called Ian Scratching His Head Delicious.
I think I got it.
It's my favorite game. No, we have all been playing a game called Pokemon Legends Arceus. As the English person says it in the trailer.
Can I tell you how I found out? I don't want to say the definitive way, but the way that makes the most sense. I happened to watch a TikTok and somebody said, I think it was a Scottish accent, which I'm not going to do, but he said it's called Arceus because if it was Arceus, then in the game, you would have an Arse phone with you and not an Arc phone.
I understand.
The other thing I saw was there's like a move or a TM or something called RKS that is based off of Arceus. Mm. So you wouldn't pronounce it that way.
Are there TMs in this game? And I've just not encountered
any of
them.
No. Like in Pokemon canon.
Okay, I got you.
Wait, aren't there? There are kind of TMs, though, with the gym person at
the
home,
security
right?
Core.
Where you you can like buy moves.
I like barely talk.
I'm sorry, I'm jumping ahead. Yeah.
It's different.
Yeah, it's a little bit different. But I was like, oh, so that's the definitive way to say it. And then in the Japanese trailer, he says, Arceus. And it's like, okay, well, there goes the hard K.
Arecifon. Arecifon.
And Karen loves saying it like that.
Wait. But I don't know if, was he pronouncing it in Japanese or in...
I think he's pronouncing it in Japanese.
What's the name of that, like
kanji?
Japanese pronunciation of English words?
Oh,
there's like there's like a name for it. Like how there's a Japanese movie called House, but in Japan they pronounce it Hausu, and there's like literally a term for that type of, I don't want to call it bastardization, but kind of like a Spanish type thing.
Yeah, I feel like we brought that, because he says, he's talking Japanese, and then he says, Pokemon Legends Arceus. And it's like it's like a weird thing in another language when someone says English words all of a sudden. So I get what you're saying. Like, I wonder if that is sort of that
I'm gonna look at
that thing. So anyways, I have, if I understand correctly, Jake,
I just Googled Japanese English pronunciation, and the first Google result is just picture. It's just a picture of lips, and it says sounds like Japanese. Like, I know how to pronounce Japanese, okay?
Yeah, do you not know what it sounds like?
I'm gonna give up. I'm gonna give up on my Google. I apologize.
Jake, you have finished the game. You said at the time of finish, you had 26 hours.
I rolled credits.
You rolled credits.
Yes, you sped run it. Any percent?
I kind of blasted through the main story because I got tired of it.
Yes. Okay, I like the direction this is going.
Yeah.
Okay, Will, where are you? Where are you in the game?
I am 21 hours in, and I finished my last lord. I calmed him down. A frenzied lord. And now there's a little bit more to do, as far as I can tell.
Oh, there's
where are you at?
More to do.
I am about 6 hours in, and I just calmed my second lord. And I think I may be done with the game.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. We'll get into it. Let's hear the positives first, and then because there has to be a party for me to piss on. Okay, you can't just piss out on your own. So you guys go first, and then let me come in and be Debbie Downer Incorporated.
Debbie Downer. Okay, so I'll start as the resident second Pokemon game ever. I've only ever beat one. I've really enjoyed it so far. The first couple areas, I really like rolled around a lot, caught a lot of Pokemon, leveled up. Like, I think I leveled up a bunch of my like stars. I got a bunch of those before I'd even like changed a couple chapters in. And then I really like doing all the little requests for people, because a lot of them were either easy or like that just right amount of challenging, where you're like, oh, I'll go try to find this thing. I still can't find a 2-foot, 8-inch Beelzel.
I saw an article that is like a practically impossible task. There's barely anybody who's been able to do it.
Wait, yeah, I have a 2.7 inch.
The guy outside the front gate?
2'7". Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that was the very first quest, the very first request that I did.
No, he has two requests. The first one is to bring him one, and the second one is to bring him a bigger one.
That's like 2'8" or bigger.
Yeah, 2'8" or bigger.
Really? I brought him a bigger one.
Oh, I hate
it. Maybe it was like an alpha or something.
The biggest one I've caught is 2'7". I can't. I was like, no.
When he said 2'8", I said, blow it out your ass, buddy. Find your own.
Go find your own. So I like all that stuff. I like the openness of the like there's so many things that I've wanted to do since, you know, first playing Fire Red 3 months ago. But like throwing all my Pokemon pals out to just hang out with them is cool. And like the way the battles are structured, just tossing it everything, like the camera angles, you have all the stats there. And then if you have that info dump, it just tells you effective, not effective, super effective. And you just have everything right there in front of you, and you don't have to like go to a summary screen to check if you need this thing or blah blah blah. So I really enjoy all that. What's the other? I don't remember. I'm gonna say, Jake, I'll throw it over to you to hit us with some positives.
Yeah, I wrote down a bunch of notes. I kept having a bunch of thoughts as I was playing this. I've not played a mainline Pokemon game since Diamond and Pearl, which was fourth gen, 2006 or 2007, I think it was. But I played, you know, I played Gold and Silver and Ruby and Sapphire. And I played Pokemon Snap, Pokemon Colosseum, a bunch of kind of tangential Pokemon stuff, but not any of the mainline games since Diamond and Pearl. So this was jumping back into kind of the traditional Pokemon experience. And I think a lot of my likes are similar to Will's. I liked the gameplay for the most part. I liked being able to kind of go out and you're sneaking around and you're catching stuff. And I liked that all of the balls felt different. They had like a different flavor of throw You know, the flying balls and the ones that are heavy, and then just the traditional ones, your Pokeball, your Great Ball, your Ultra Ball that had, you know, they're normal. But I like that there was a little bit of tacticality to that obviously isn't present in the regular, you know, top-down turn-based ones. Mm-hmm. Or even in stuff like Pokemon Go, where, yeah, you're throwing it yourself, but they all feel exactly the same. Checking my notes. I liked that I was able to just, you didn't always have to battle like the alpha Pokemon. You could just catch them if you were careful enough.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah.
You didn't know that, Will?
I always just fought them and caught them.
You're talking about... Oh, wait. So you... I'm sorry. What's the surprise about?
Alpha Pokemon.
Yeah.
What's Will surprised about? That you can catch them without battling them?
Yeah, what is Will's surprise?
I just never tried. I just assumed you couldn't. I thought you had to fight Alpha and then catch them in the battle.
Okay, yeah.
Nah, you can just sneak up and throw something.
If you sneak them and you get lucky, yeah, you can.
Right, yeah. For some reason, I thought that was the, like, they always have the red. I think I tried it once with one that had a red X and noticed me. But I think I just, from that point, was like, oh, they're always angry. You can't catch them, you know? But I would always catch them just in battle.
Yeah. So there is a certain bit that towards about the halfway point of getting to the end of the main story, sneaking around and catching Pokemon just kind of organically felt so good that the combat then felt kind of meaningless, especially since I could catch alpha Pokemon without fighting them. Where I was like, oh, this is weird. And like anytime I got into a battle with another person, I don't know, it just kind of felt off, but we'll get more back to that. I liked most of the music. There are a couple tunes that just felt a little goofy that I didn't necessarily care for. I think the Pokemon look great by and large, as do their animations, which is obviously where most of the animation budget went.
Yes.
And Will had talked about the quality of life improvements. I liked that there were icons indicating, you know, attacks that are strong and weak against what opponent, and you could even go into your menu, like if a Pokemon faints, and then you can plan which one you want to throw out if you can't. Because all that in the other games is just memory. Like, you have to remember what Pokemon is what and this and that. And then if you encounter a new Pokemon that you don't necessarily know what type it is, you're just kind of like, let's try a couple of things. So I like that was all just there in the combat screen.
Yeah.
I liked that evolution could be determined by the player, not just that you pass a level threshold and then your Pokemon evolves. I know you can cancel that in the mainline games, but I didn't the first time I played one of those. So I was like, okay, well, I guess... You know, I really like my Pikachu, but I guess it's a Raichu now. I like that this gives you the choice. That's what I liked about it.
Yeah, and I think, like, just to add on, that you've reminded me of a couple things. Like, definitely that evolution thing. I like that everyone earned XP when you did stuff.
Yes.
Like EXP share by default.
They are... And they handed out liberally.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and that's a little worrisome because at some points it felt like, oh, this guy's level 20 already? I didn't feel like I earned that, you know?
Yeah,
so it's a little give and take there.
I felt very overpowered by the time I got to end credits. And there was one aim thing after that suddenly I was underpowered, which was frustrating. Oof. But. Yeah.
I also really like that you can just go change moves whenever, and just like you don't have to worry about forgetting moves or anything. You can just be
and
like,
it's not permanent.
Yeah, totally. It's awesome, and also changing names, that mostly makes sense because you're getting so many of a Pokemon anyways. Like, you might just be swapping them or doing that. It's just like, I feel like they took a lot of systems that you had to go to a person to do in a Pokemon game and just let you do it whenever. And I think just across the board for any video game, that's great. Like, you've made it easier for the player to enjoy the game and not be like, oh, I have to run all the way back to Bill to re-nickname my guy, or I have to run all the way. And that's why when I came across
this TM again, because I, you know, Yeah.
When I came across that guy who's like, oh, I tell you the level of friendship you have with your Pokemon. I'm like, just put it as a stat. Just let me know.
Yeah.
I don't want to go to you to ask you something.
And they did the same thing. The same thing with menus. Like before, it was a lot of menu presses deep to find certain things or certain descriptions. And this is a game that is on an HD console, and they use that full UI to show a lot of that right up front, as opposed to burying it behind a lot of menus.
Yeah. Ian, do you want to hit any positives that you might have had before we hit negative 10?
I mean, honestly, I think you guys kind of got it all. Like, it's a lot of fun seeing Pokemon in the world. A lot of the quality of life improvement stuff is really good. I just appreciate how much they changed the Pokemon formula with this. I don't think all of it lands, but they've kind of been skating by with just a lot of samey Pokemon games for a long time. So for them to come out and, I mean, I would call this a mainline Pokemon game, even though it's with the Pokemon Legends. It got the press, it got the marketing, it got the budget, it got the sales figures of a mainline Pokemon game, and they made a lot of changes. And I really appreciate that with them. Can I talk about the negatives now?
Yeah, you hit those negatives.
I have a fair amount as well.
Me too.
Look, I before I talk about the negatives, like, I don't think these are necessarily the fault of Game Freak. That is the name of the Pokemon, right? Game Freak?
Yeah,
I know that's right.
Nintendo and the Pokemon Company, but then Game Freak develops most of the games.
It just never, for some reason, Game Freak and Pokemon, it just never feels right to me. But anyways, the things that don't work in this game, like, I don't think they're their fault. It's everybody's fault. And let me take a step back. I went to middle school and high school in Carroll County, Maryland. And when I was there in the mid to late 2000s, about 5 to 10 years prior, there had been a big like heroin epidemic in
the middle
Carroll County. In the high school, and I think in the middle school a little bit. And it was weird because we're in the middle of like rural farmland. Like it's just like middle of nowhere kind of place. And it was just weird that all of a sudden heroin swept through. And the reason why I bring that up is because there was a kind of famous slash infamous anti-drug video that was made in Carroll County in the high school I went to. And it kind of went all over the nation, and it was called Heroin Kills. And there was a very funny line towards the end of the movie, and it's when the main character is overdosing on heroin and he's having like this like death dream, and he's just like, I did this to me, as he's overdosing. And I feel like that's what I'm screaming while I'm playing this game and not enjoying it, is I did this to me, because like, we've talked about this previously, and I feel like every Pokemon fan has dreamed of this since the very beginning, which is like full 3D graphics, open world. I want to see the Pokemon everywhere. I want to actually throw the ball. I want all these things. I want XP for all this stuff. You know, I want this fully realized 3D world. Hey, by golly darn it, they did it. And it turns out it's not as good as a normal Pokemon game, because it's just part of it is bad execution. Like the Pokemon spawns in the overworld. Like, I'm going to skip over the graphics and the world design, because we all know universally it's not good in this game. Mm-hmm. It's just not good. And that's all you need to know. But even just the way the Pokemon are in the world and the way that they spawn and the where they are located, it feels like I am playing a mediocre MMO, where it's like, in this area, this is your loot, this is your spawn table for which monsters can appear. And when they appear, they are in here and they have like a generic idle animation back and forth. I was trying to think of Far Cry 3 sprung to my mind. Like, when you're hunting the animals in Far Cry 3, it feels like they're really in there. Even though they have quote-unquote spawn areas and you go to an area because you know it'll be there, it's still like you're trying to actually hunt it and you find it. And then you're like, oh, I got to take it out and deal with it. But this is literally just like, I'm in this area. Yeah, there's the Poniata. There's another Geodude. There's Magikarp. They're just kind of wandering around. Okay, let me go over there and mess with that spawn location to deal with that monster that spawned there. And then just like I don't think The throwing's interesting in a way, but like the whole idea of like the free-floating camera while you're battling, like it's such a cool idea. I have always wanted that, but within two battles I was done with it, you know, because it's just like you start the battle. I had one battle that started because I got attacked by a Pokemon. I threw my Pokemon out and I spent the first 10 seconds of the battle just moving the camera around and then moving my character around because for some reason it was happening behind my legs, directly behind me, and I couldn't see it. And so it's like, yeah, they're doing cool animations, but I want to see it, like block the camera back. But again, I can't really blame Game Freak because I did this to me. I wanted this. This is what everybody wanted. They did what we wanted, and it turns out we wanted something that's not as good as the original. I don't know. Am I crazy here? Am I crazy?
You're not crazy.
I, as a Pokemon expert and champion, I'll have you know, I really, really, really like the free camera stuff. I think it's great. I think the one thing they need to fix, this came up in our playthrough on Saturday. The one thing is the other top corner should just have the enemy's health in it.
Yes, 100%.
Yeah, if it was a big Pokemon, sometimes it would get hid behind the letterboxing. Yes.
But every time, I've had one or two in your situation, Ian, but every time it's pretty much nailed it where the camera needs to be. And if it messes up, it's because I run around or something. But if it isn't a free camera thing, I want a locked camera angle with me in the world in the next Pokemon.
Yeah, or even just like give me like that very cinematic camera movement feel where it's just like I can pan a little bit left to right, or even do like the Persona thing where it's locked, but it's so gosh darn stylized into the battle mode and during the battle mode that it's just like I don't even care my camera's locked because you're presenting it 10 times fancier than I could ever make it. Like the way they did it was like, hey, you can move around and look anywhere during a battle mode. That sounds awesome. In practice, it kind of sucks, honestly. Yeah.
I think my takeaway, like my compromise takeaway, is have the battles take place in the overworld and don't put me in a separate, like, JRPG set where I fight things, you know?
I think that's a good compromise. Yeah.
And then I just, before Jake absolutely dump trains on this game, I just want to say, graphics aside, the graphics in this game could be improved. If I think I wouldn't have noticed how bad these graphics are if there was any sort of anti-aliasing at all on anything.
I disagree.
Because like when your character goes into the water, it is just solid pixels of white around them. It is
also
mind-blowing.
When you're underground.
Yes, when you're underground
just,
too,
like,
in
a
the
white
darkness.
Border around everything.
Yeah, through those cave sections. It's just mind-blowing, that stuff.
I mean, I hear you, and we talked about this a little bit the other day, but, like, Breath of the Wild has better graphics, but it's not like, markedly better graphics, but just the world design is so much better in Breath of the Wild, so that even though when you look at a certain space, it's, like, ground textures, not that good. Tree textures, not that good in Breath of the Wild. But because of how they've placed the trees and broken up the sight lines and had a mountain here and then there's a glowing tower over here, it looks good. Whereas like every time you spawn into an area in Pokemon Legends, you turn away from the camp and you walk toward the open land and you're like, look at this big, flat, empty place with, I guess there's like a puddle there and there's four trees. And it's just like, the world design is, they're not helping themselves.
Similar to film, good lighting can really help.
Oh,
shot.
Yeah.
And that, I think that's also half of what the issue is in this game, is the lighting is terrible.
Yeah.
The lighting is terrible. It's just, as someone who played Breath of the Wild within the past year, I you lose yourself in Breath of the Wild and you may ignore some of those things. But I would also argue, to your point that I didn't even think about, Ian, Breath of the Wild has better animal interactions than these Pokemon interact with each other in this game. It's just, I had something else I was going to say, but I really don't remember what it was. Jake, please inform us of your take.
Yeah, run dump train on this game.
No, so the whole time I was playing it, I hate playing armchair game dev because I can't do it. I couldn't make, if somebody told me, hey, make a Pokemon and make it interact with something in an open world. I can't even do that. But my brain just started like trying to figure out what money was spent where, because I think there's very obvious places where a lot of time was spent and then other places where not a lot of time was spent. And we already, you know, it's been the dead horse of how this game looks has already been beaten over and over and over by, if you're coming to this podcast to, because you're familiar with this game, you already know. So we're not going to talk about it any more than even we already have. Apart from it felt to me almost like a planet on No Man's Sky.
Yeah.
With that kind of animal, the creatures just kind of wandering around, and the world does not feel handcrafted. It feels
perfect.
Kind of procedurally generated. And that was super weird to me that like Game Freak's not a small company, and it's not like they didn't have, I mean, I don't know how much money the Pokemon Company or Nintendo is giving them. I don't know what the budget for this game was, but I can't imagine that there would be a lack of resources at their disposal. So I think it must have just been a matter of figuring out what to focus on in order to just get the game done.
Yeah. I mean, I hear you, but my only pushback on that is like, my graphics aside, again, the graphics are terrible, but I'm fine with that. If the design is solid, if like the world design is there and everything.
Yeah.
And like,
cause even like Outer Wilds is not a phenomenally, you wouldn't look at that and be like, ooh, yeah, these textures it's soft and it's chunky, but it works. Cause
it's also
the,
like
in service of the art direction,
that stuff in Breath of the Wild is less is more. And it's like they imported super high res textures and then just dialed them to the lowest settings rather than designing textures to be low res.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah.
100%. Yeah. And I think now that I said the words art direction and then suddenly I was like, oh yeah, I feel like this is not a game with maybe very defined art direction, because even like the Pokemon models, once you're actually in the battle, or even when like Will said, you throw them out in front of you and you're just kind of hanging out with them, the Pokemon look pretty good. Like I'm not expecting them to look like Detective Pikachu, not like, you know, Unreal Engine 5 Pokemon, but they look fine and they all look great. But because especially compared to new Pokemon Snap, which came out last year, the Pokemon look pretty close to that. It's really just the world and kind of everything else that doesn't necessarily meet that standard.
I think like the closest they come to a unique style is the historic setting and the costumes and the buildings, etc.
Yeah, the little photography area you can go to.
Yeah. But that is nowhere near as prolific throughout the game, the world, and the UI as it should be.
Yeah. So, on that note, the animation of everything that isn't a Pokemon is, like, there are some characters
generic.
That may as well be just T-posing. They're just kind of standing there, and it's very obvious, and, like, I totally understand all the Pokemon are rigged and animated individually. And there's so many of them. So I can totally imagine, like, you know, they all have different skeletons. They're all going to be doing something different. That so many hours probably were spent just animating all the Pokemon, because you have that look good, because that's the selling point of the game. Then by the time they got to figuring out the cutscenes and the human characters, it was just, you know, okay, figure it out. But they spend so much time with the human characters. There are so many cutscenes in this game that I just skip. And it's so dull and lifeless compared to the Pokemon that I was like, we should not be spending this much time with the human characters. And I tried every single gosh darn button on my Switch to skip through those cutscenes.
I like
the power and button. I could not.
Every cutscene was like setting, character walks up, talk a little bit, next character walks up. And it's like, It's just little slide, which is fine.
If the dialogue is very funny and kitschy, like it is with a lot of the Pokemon games. It really wasn't, though.
But and the other thing is... Sorry, you go, Jake.
You go.
I was just going to say, the other thing that really annoyed me, and I don't know if this is different in Pokemon, but it's certainly different in like Zelda and stuff, is when two lines of text fill a screen and you hit A, usually a new screen pops up with new text. But in this game, it scrolls one line up and adds a line underneath. So I kept rereading the first line every single time because I'm used to just a new, whole new two lines of text popping in. And I don't know.
I feel like we're nitpicking, so maybe we should move on to the news section at this point.
Wait, I've got more things that are different.
Oh my God.
Sorry. No, that was just because narratively it's kind of dumb. I thought that, like, I didn't fully understand why there was this focus on taming guardians to do the special traversal and not just have that be Pokemon that had those moves like in all the other games. Yeah, that weird flute bit. Flute.
No way makes that sound.
You're gonna have to blur that on the archive.
And then managing the Pokemon storage, managing the pastures, like, because you have to catch a bunch of the Pokemon in order to fill out the specific, you know, tasks on the Pokedex. And then you're like, I've got a million different things. I only need one of them for storage. But trying to manage that thing, there was no way to sort.
There's no sort button. How is there no sort button? There's a sort items button.
Sort for your inventory, yeah, but not for the Pokemon.
I hated that.
Ugh.
And the lettering on the house.
No, I thought the initial premise of the story is interesting.
Yeah,
and then it just I don't know. It's.
I feel like it's not going to pay off.
Okay, they use the same narrative twist twice.
Yes.
Well, then maybe it's three times because,
I thought you meant the other character.
Yeah, there's cause I'm well past the end credits at this point, and there's still a bunch of story happening. There's like, I don't know. It's the story's really dumb and it does not pay off. I thought it was going to go one way. Like this idea of coming back, you're back in time to a period in history where Pokemon training is in its infancy. And I thought it was going to build up to like the establishment of the first Pokemon League or something of like, because everybody in this world is like, oh my goodness, Pokemon are the scariest things in the whole world. Pokemon are terrifying and frightening. Did you just see that Weedle? It's monstrous.
They are big. Giant caterpillar, yeah.
But I thought it was going to lead to, especially with you filling out the Pokedex and kind of, there's a couple people who are like, well, maybe, you know, it's this symbiosis between people and Pokemon. I thought was going to lead somewhere that would be like a stepping stone for like, oh, this is where all the games start. This is the moment. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't do that.
Yeah.
Yeah. The story's not even serviceable like it is in middling Pokemon games.
Yeah. Because I was thinking of it. I'm like, is this like, if I'm 12, is this story interesting to me? And it's not.
Although, if you ask me, I have no idea what the story in Fire Red was at all.
You're filling out your Pokedex and then.
Gyms, yeah.
Yeah. And Rocket Team is bad. They're just bullies. That's pretty
much
it.
But
you enjoyed it.
Let me be clear. I am enjoying this game a lot. I'm having a fun time. I will be beating it. I don't know if I'm doing this post credit crap.
Well, let's cap this off. I need to ask you guys a question. Is this going on the Subpixel Game of the Year 2022 consideration list?
No.
Will it make the top 10?
I doubt it.
I mean, if nothing good comes out for the rest of the year, yes.
Really?
Sure, yeah. I think
I'm saying top 10, so you guys don't think it'll make top 10.
I think it could.
Okay, so let's put it on the list then, because we three have played it. Let's get Kyle to play it.
I was going to put it on the list.
It's the whole purpose.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I think this is maybe similar to like Pokemon was such a integral part of my childhood and kind of throughout my adulthood as well. It was just always kind of there. I'm like, oh yeah, I really like that. That I think similar to why I didn't like Rise of Skywalker so much, because I really like Star Wars, that this was maybe, because I love Pokemon so much, it was more disappointing than it should have been. The parts of it that were fun were really fun.
Yeah.
But then the parts of it, I'm like, well, that's unfortunate that it wasn't better.
Yeah,
totally.
That's a good point.
Great. That was a good Pokemon discussion. I mean, that's exactly what I wanted by having you two on today. First, before we hit the news, we got to play the news theme, which means me hitting this button and me also hitting this button.
Here's the news. We're talking about news. It's gaming news. What's up, news?
Classic.
What's up, news?
What's up?
What's up, news? What's up,
I
man?
I did this to me.
I did
this to me.
I'm gonna see if this is online.
Yeah, you gotta find that. Big news of the week, folks. Huge, huge acquisition occurred just days ago. The New York Times has purchased Wordle for low seven figures.
Wait, wow. Really?
Yes.
Guys, I hadn't
I'm
seen
sorry.
A number attached
I'm sorry.
To it.
I have some breaking news. I did not find heroin kills, but I did find on the Office of the State's Attorney, Carroll County, Maryland website, a sequel called Heroin Still Kills.
Oh, no.
Heroin Strikes Again.
This
He's
looks
back.
Like it's from like within the last 3 years.
Heroin
this,
with a
no.
vengeance.
Heroin Still Kills. I'm glad they like understand what's happening. I'm sorry, didn't mean to interrupt.
Yes, James Wardle, a software engineer in Brooklyn, for a price in the low seven figures, sold his website Wordle to the New York Times. My only takeaway from this is good for him. Get paid.
Oh, yeah.
For what you made.
Yeah,
you're
yes.
set
yes.
for realistically, you're pretty comfortable for the rest of your life, and you
yeah.
can you're still young enough to keep making money. You could make another hit. I'm very proud of you, and just congratulations. You know,
there were some people talking about on Twitter, other game devs, etc., being like, honestly, this guy making a really interesting game. It taking off and then he cashes out with at least $1 million and doesn't have to deal with like copycats or ongoing the game or trying to
yeah,
monetize it in any way is like
dream.
Unfortunately that is the best case scenario right now yeah. given the state of the internet.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't want to have to deal with paywalls in the future, because New York Times said it'll initially be free, you can go to the website Wordle, right click, hit save as. And then you literally have the game for the rest of your life. So go ahead and do that if you don't want to pay for it. Any other thoughts here on Wordle?
I have not played it.
It's great. It's fun. I had a really good rush the other day because I got my first two guesses. It was fantastic. First guess, nothing. No correct letters at all. Second guess, five greens, baby. I did it. That's like the best.
Today, I had my first 5 out of 6 because I knew.
Yeah, I think I did that too. Yeah,
I knew the word I did. Yeah, it was the last letter. I tried 3 different last letters to try to do it. And I couldn't.
Yeah.
And I got a 5 out of 6. I've been hitting 4s and I've got a couple 3. But I only started like a week ago.
It's a fun game. It's just literally every morning I wake up. And I just do it after I wake up, and it's like a nice little brain refresher. I'm never going to play it once it goes to the New York Times, though, because
no.
screw
right
them
click,
and all their paywalls.
As, Ian.
But okay, Ian, democracy dies in darkness.
Excuse me, folks.
Democracy dies behind paywalls.
That
Anyways,
is
let's move on.
That's the bell to move on. We're going to move on to the actual.
It will be paywalled.
I don't remember how to. Oh,
did you do it okay over there, buddy?
Yeah, I was trying to strike through, and I couldn't remember the key combination. Folks, Jake, the stupid winter snow temple in Pokemon was awful, and I hate it. That's
no, I was actually backwards.
I was getting to that point and being like, there's usually more puzzles in mainline Pokemon games. And then it got to that and I was like, I see why they did not do this.
I refuse to write it down.
I had to write it down.
No, I memorized it. Sony bought Bungie, folks. For less than the price of a Star War.
This doesn't seem like a great purchase because of the price and the things that have come out later, where basically they're like, yeah, Bungie's just going to keep doing what they're doing, and we're just not going to make them exclusive.
Yes, Will and I were talking about this a little bit. Yeah, Will and I were talking about this a little bit before the podcast, where from the Sony press release and from the Bungie press release, I think that this purchase was primarily so Sony can capitalize on Bungie's intellectual properties as multimedia. Within a couple of years, we're going to get an announcement of a TV show or a movie. I know that Bungie has already been hiring for folks to develop comics, books, whatever, to kind of flesh out the universe. And I think that's what Sony is trying to get in on, especially since they've got, they've got Uncharted coming to theaters soon. They've got the HBO Last of Us series in post-production.
I think that's a good move. I don't think it's a $4 billion move, though. Maybe they'll
strike gold and the Destiny feature film will crack $1 billion at the box office.
There was also Sony's been having a recent push for games as a service. I think it was they were saying they want a couple games as a service within the next
Bungie's
couple years.
Tools.
And I think
you say that, but Bungie has a, I don't want to call it barely functioning, but they have a very rambunctious live service where people keep playing it even though they hate it. And it's just like,
I don't hate it.
So my point is Sony wants to get into that. So they bought a company that's done it so poorly that now they know not what not to do.
They go in a room. They got Bungie in a room and they say, what should we do? And Bungie says, do this. And they leave the room and they go, we should not do this.
No, the guy exactly walks in and says, what should we do? The guy tells them, then you hear a loud bang, and then the next person walks in. Says, what should we do?
We should publish all our lore in physical volumes outside of the game.
On a website.
And then screw over the third-party contractor that did all the work on it. Yeah.
And then fire Joseph Staten.
Bungie, please fire me.
Yeah, this is interesting. Who knows? They were saying this deal's been being talked about since
TV show,
like November, I want to say. And I bet they closed just because of the big news last week and the big news the week before. Yeah. People just keep buying people, and it's never going to stop.
And Jeff Keighley's like, just wait, folks. But wait, there's more. Because I guess he knows something.
I got really mad at that because at least Jeff Grubb tries to like hint at something. But it's like at that point, if all you say is like, guys, there's more coming, I know about it. At that point, you're just showing off, you know, you're just showing. You're not teasing.
We get it.
You're not giving
Jeff.
Us any actual information. You're not even like playing a cutesy game.
We know
you're
you
just
know
showing
people.
Off.
Yeah, it's not like I talk about Sony games that may be coming out soon that I play. Moving on in the news, X-Men.
Are you playing Gran Turismo?
No, I'm not.
Oh, okay. I'll come up early. I'll play it.
I want to say this. I wish I had the Polygon headline, because the Polygon headline was going around in our Slack as one of the craziest headlines ever. But anyways, there was a report that a company is working on an Xbox exclusive. Oh, I'm reading the wrong headline. The X-Men scribe David Hayter, also known as the voice of Solid Snake, is working on a TV adaptation of EA's American McGee's Alice game. Okay.
Yeah. I never played American McGee's Alice because I think it was in that period where I was probably like 10 or 11 at the time, and I couldn't really afford the game. But it looked awesome, and I always really appreciated the style they had in those games. So
which Doom level did he make?
I don't remember, but like,
oh, I don't know.
His style is always so unique that heck yeah, man, give him a TV show. Let's do it.
Do it,
like
girl.
Gaming's Tim Burton.
But is he? Exactly. He's not attached to the TV show. Just David Hayter.
He's not attached. Well, then how is his? I thought he owned the property.
Well, yeah, maybe he does.
Like Tom Clancy's Splinter Cell.
Yeah.
Sorry, I'm just skimming this article.
Tom Clancy, one of the most prolific game designers of our generation.
Oh, no, you're right. Currently, McGee is developing the sequel, Alice Asylum, and Oz Adventures, a narrative game based on the L. Frank Baum classics. So he's not part of it. But at the same time, it's such a cool world that they can do it.
Hello, cat. That was a cat butt on stream. I had no idea David Hayter was also a writer.
Is he?
What do you mean, is he?
According to the news.
I'm just asking, are we sure
this it is the same person?
Okay. Because we've had that mistake before.
No,
like
I made sure to check. I looked it up because I thought it was so wild. It is literally the same person.
I mean, good for him.
No, that's okay, great. Look, I just had no idea.
It's going to sound mean. It's going to sound off the cuff. But like, if you can get into that industry as a voice actor, et cetera, then you've already made some connections. And at that point, connections is half the game right there, you know? So
the other half is not to diminish his solid five.
That's right. That's not to diminish his talent at all. Just to say he's got the connections. So him spinning off into a different part of that industry totally makes sense.
Yeah, totally. It's just, it's wild. Speaking of TV shows, the It Takes Two is partnering with a company to adapt the game for a film or TV show. You know, not the worst video game to TV, like, news adaptation. Like, I can see that.
Okay, you say that, but I have not played the game. But it's my understanding that it presents a cute front, but is really actually, like, a dark and depressing story about divorce. And so I'm wondering, what is this? Is this going to be kind of like Sausage Party, where it's like presenting a cute face like it's for a kid's movie, but then in reality it just has all these like dark adult themes to it? So I'm not quite sure.
The adult themes in It Takes Two are very apparent because it's still the parents are the dolls and they're talking about it the whole time. Like, it's not like some subtle thing like Sausage Party. But I can see less of a TV show. I can see a movie where at the beginning the kid's like, I wish my parents weren't fighting anymore. And then they turn into things and then they do some sort of magical thing to get turned back. I didn't play the game, so I have no idea what happens in it. But I can see it like Mousetrap / The Borrowers / that Ghibli movie sort of vibes to it. I think that'll be neat. And then moving on to our final TV show news of the week. The Halo TV show trailer premiered during one of the football games.
That's
over
right.
The weekend.
It was
as specific as we can be.
The Bengals Kansas City AFC championship. I only know that because I happened to be at my parents' house while it was playing, and I looked over at one point and I was like, oh, that's right, the Halo trailer is playing in the middle
like
of
Master
this.
Chief.
Is that the Master Chief?
I also know that because I ran Madden simulations for work. Which was awesome. Ian's gonna watch it right now we're not gonna hear it, but he's not gonna hear us. Yeah. But we're gonna hear him react to it. That's how we set this up about 2 minutes before the show went live. So here Ian goes.
Okay, you ready?
Go.
How knowledgeable are you in Halo lore, Ian? What is he gonna recognize?
Wait. One second. I'm sorry if you felt.
Jake, I am very versed in Halo lore, unfortunately. Up until like Halo 3 is my main area. But this trailer made me angry.
Do you think Keith David is going to be in the TV
show? I'm sorry.
Show?
I don't think this is going to work. Apparently in Discord, if you deafen, it also mutes you. You can't mute the line but not yourself.
You can drag both of our sliders down.
Oh, can you just mute us?
Let's do that. Let me try that. Folks, I'm trying it.
He's trying it, folks.
Bring back Keith David.
Keith David, treasure. National treasure.
Hey.
Want him to be
valid point. Okay, can you still hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
All right, I am starting the trailer.
Muhammad in the chat says he feels like it'll be a flop. I can see that. I think we were talking about lighting earlier, and I think this trailer suffers from lighting.
Too much or too little?
Too not sci-fi lighting. Sci-fi channel lighting.
Just kind of flat.
Just the Master Chief.
Very flat.
It is the Master Chief again.
I like seeing the reflections on his face.
I saw a Chevy Tahoe.
Wanted to see that cat.
You know, this looks good so far.
So far.
It looks like The Expanse, honestly. The same style and lighting and everything.
I would agree with that. I haven't watched much of The Expanse.
Okay. Man,
it's so good.
I'm rewatching Battlestar right now.
Okay.
Is it streaming anywhere?
Oh, I'm not. I don't like the Peacock. Voice. I'm sorry.
But yeah, it doesn't look great.
Also, I could send you a link if you would like.
No. I want to stream it legally or get it on
Blu-ray. They're
my
rip. I own the Blu-rays.
Oh. I still feel weird.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay. I don't like Cortana. I just saw her.
I appreciate that it is Jen Taylor, though.
Yes.
Oh, no. I hear the song now. Oh, God. I'm sorry. I just heard the song.
Oh, that song cover is so bad. So bad.
Who is this? I'm confused. Is that Sarge? Because if it is, I love it.
I think that's an unknown Marine.
Come in here tonight.
Didn't they use a cover of In the Air Tonight for Dead Space 3?
Unmuting now.
Did they?
I think in one of the trailers, yeah.
Ian.
I don't know why it's not Steve Downes.
Because they want him to take his helmet off and walk around and be able to talk.
You can still, voice outside the helmet.
Do we know for certain that he's going to do that, though?
Walk around and talk?
Without the helmet.
That would be really weird.
It would be, but they specifically said they didn't want to use his voice, A, because he's older, and B, they wanted the actor to be the voice to make it easy.
Yeah, but it could be like Mandalorian, where... Like, you do see him very sporadically, but you could just as easily do Mandalorian, never hearing
also,
him, but having the
I'm not
there's
saying they're right. I'm saying that's their justification.
Decades of precedent for having an actor be the body and have a different actor be the voice.
That's
Lawrence
why I think
Fishburne
they're going to have his helmet
the voice
off.
Of the Silver Surfer, even though Doug Jones was the mocap performer.
All right, let me
James
give
Earl
my take
Jones
on this.
Was Darth Vader.
Let me give my take on this real
that
quick.
Suit.
David Prowse was the body.
So I had only seen like very quick clips, like on my phone or on a bad TV or like people posting screenshots, and those don't look good. But honestly, in action on a good screen, it doesn't look that bad.
I think it looks fine.
Yeah, it looks like The Expanse, where it's like 95% of the way there as really good looking sci-fi. It just needs a little bit more cinematography and polish on it. That's all.
I think all the Spartans and people look good. I just think anytime I see realistic Master Chief armor, it looks like someone wearing a suit of Master Chief armor. Like, it
cosplay.
Never has that right bulk.
Yeah, but that's tough. I hear that. I think the story's got some stuff in it. I don't understand. That lady is not from Halo lore, right?
No.
The blonde lady? So they're doing something
The blonde lady's Halsey.
No, the other blonde lady.
Oh, the Covenant blonde lady?
Covenant one?
No, she's not in it.
So they're doing some interesting stuff here. I respect that. And it looks like they are actually trying to make this more of a human story, which I appreciate. Because I don't know if you guys ever read the screenplay from... Oh, shit. Who did The Beach? Alex Garland?
Wait, Alex, are you about to tell me that Alex Garland wrote a Halo screenplay?
He did, and it's out
there.
And it's basically just the first, it's just the first game as like a generic action movie, and it's serviceable. That's it. And this is them, and they could have totally done that with this, but they're actually taking it as a series to tell a unique story and to have a human angle on it. I'm pretty sure. Can we get some Google confirmation from Jake once he finds it? It's
what?
Was it true?
Well, I'm finding, there's a link on scribed.com, Halo screenplay by Alex Garland, and it's a 128 page PDF dated, it says Alex Garland, February 6, 2005. Does that sound
about right? Yeah, because I read it late 2000s, yeah.
A series of scorched snapshots, it's not fragments as memory. This is Master Chief's dream. Okay.
Oh, this is an extra life goal, I think.
So, yeah. So, honestly, I think sitting down and giving it an honest shot, I am now excited for this. This looks a lot better than I thought it would. But it's still not as good as the Paramount Plus commercial in which they have a whole bunch of actors from Paramount Plus shows singing the Halo theme.
It's so bad.
Including Lieutenant Dangle from Reno 911. And it's just like
so bad.
And what's her name? She's a famous actress.
Kim Kardashian. I posted
it. No, it's like, it's not Joan Crawford, is it? No, it's like
Whoopi Goldberg.
Who I'm talking about. Anyways, very famous older actress, and she's
Helen
just
Mirren.
Singing the Halo song. Yeah. I'll look it up. It's bonkers.
Also, one of the people at the beginning has an AK-47, which is still alive 500 years from now.
Maggie Smith. That's a reliable, dependable weapon.
And a Chevy, I think it's a Chevy Tahoe. SUV on that planet 500 years from now.
Okay, look, they're on Paramount Plus, folks. They ain't got much of a budget, probably. So,
but just don't have a car or an AK-47.
But they've also got, they've got to have, there's been a number of live action warthogs made over the years. Do they just scrap those the minute they're done with them?
Well, but it's supposed to be like, I think it's supposed to be like a colony outpost, not like a military outpost.
Sure.
Plus, I'm not super defending this. I think part of it's budget. But the other thing is like a lot of the weapons in the Halo universe for being from like, what, 2400? Or 2500, whatever the year is, they look a lot like the weapons we got laying around here right now.
That's
so
true.
It's not like that universe is crazy future tech anyways.
I also really like the guy playing Lord Hood. He's like the guy in the like naval officer uniform, the hat, older guy, is the guy who plays Dave in 2001 A Space Odyssey.
Oh, really? The voice actor?
No, not the voice actor, the actor in the TV show.
Oh, sorry, Dave Bowman. Sorry.
Yeah, yeah.
I know him.
Oh, wow.
And
that's
I was honestly kind of okay with it.
Him.
Ron Perlman played Lord Hood in the game. But I was like, this is kind of a neat thing to have that guy do it. He was also in, he was in something else. I was looking at his IMDb that I was super surprised by, and I can't remember what it was. But
Did either of you, we mentioned Forward Unto Dawn before the show started, but did either of you watch Nightfall with the Mike Coulter one? Or was that what it was called?
No, you're talking about... Are you talking about the... I forget
it. It was like a limited series.
I think it is Nightfall, yeah.
Mike Coulter leading up to...
Yeah,
the
Halo 5.
Halo 5?
Oh, I thought you were talking about the Halo 3 one. I didn't know there was one for Halo 5.
No, not the Neil Blomkamp one's pretty good.
They're fantastic. Oh my God. It's the best thing. That and the other Halo 3 ad campaign, which is... in the future, and it's the veterans talking about.
Oh yeah, no, that
diorama, some of the greatest video game related media I have ever seen.
That and there's like
Blomkamp watching those dudes get nailed with brute spikes.
Yeah.
Oh my.
And there's another commercial.
Like the first one, which was just a montage of like the factories, like the way it's edited and cut together, is just like. Yes! God, it's so good.
I'm gonna go watch those after this. There's also like the one where this song's always been stuck in my head for my life. Is like it's this African song that the lady's like singing while they're putting the helmets on the gun on the battle rifles stuck into the ground where they like buried all the people, and it's like like builds up. And also that diorama with Master Chief holding the grenade while the brute's holding him up, and like and it's the perfect diorama
in conjunction with the veteran stuff.
Because it has, like, the smoke coming out of the tanks. It's, like, the cotton. Oh, I've always... Oh, it's so good. So good.
So are we saying that all these things are going to be better than the Paramount Plus show?
No, but that's the thing is none of the things we said before should have been any good. Like, there is actually a decent amount in Halo that you can pull from to make something good in the right hands. So I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt.
The Reach trailer with what's the blue lady Spartans whose name escapes me? She's got a robot arm. No.
Cat.
She's running with the bomb into the Covenant flagship. That's really good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Giving the Covenant back their bomb. Oh, I want to play through all the Halo games now. Those are just so much fun to just sit down and play. I love it.
I just want to watch all this stuff again now.
And it's your camera got borked by your cat.
I know. I'm going to leave it. It's
great. We're pretty much done here. The rest of the news, Xbox exclusive Monster Hunter like game is being worked on. Supermassive Games filed trademarks for 5 new Dark Pictures titles. They all look great. I like Supermassive. I like their games. And then the Nintendo Switch has officially passed the Wii to become the best-selling home console of all time. It has not passed the Wii in software sales yet, but it did pass in hardware. And that's going to be it. I'm going to play the music, even though last week I played the music and it didn't come through on the recording. So I'm going to hit this button, and we're all going to hear it, folks. Thank you so much for tuning into the show tonight. I see Muhammad in the chat. Thank you for chatting with us. Karen, thanks for stopping by. And also this Russian person who got deleted by Subpixel. So thanks for stopping by. Glad you could offer us money or whatever. Women, maybe.
Don't go to that URL. If you saw it, don't go to that URL.
It's not up. It's gone. It deleted it for me and I didn't refresh. So, folks, thank you so much for tuning in. Jake, Ian, thanks for being here to discuss Pokemon Legends Arceus.
You're welcome.
I'm going to keep playing it. It's fun, it's relaxing, and it's definitely a game. Trying to think, what do we got? Saturday, Kingdom Hearts. Saturday, Ian plays Kingdom Hearts. I'm so excited.
That's right. I made a bad judgment call, and y'all forced me to play Kingdom Hearts 2. So that's starting Saturday, 8 p.m. Eastern. It's going to be hell.
I'm going to play a drinking game while you play. So look forward to calling you on Discord. Extremely drunk, maybe.
Hey, if while I'm playing you guys don't think I'm suffering enough, bring your wallets and you could make it even worse for me. That's all I'll say. A little bit of tease there.
Do it. Folks, we'll be back next week with another local chat. Until then, you can follow us, subpixelfilms.com or at subpixelteam on Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, Facebook. Whatever you do, just don't do it there. We'll see y'all next week.
Bye.
Wow, the time.